Picture this. You're sitting in your control room on a quiet Tuesday morning. Everything's running smooth. Your Scada screens show green across the board. Then suddenly, your pumps start acting erratic. Alarms fail to trigger. And within hours, you've got 250,000 gallons of raw sewage flowing into the local river. Sound like a nightmare? Well, it happened. And it was just the beginning. Hey everyone, Alana here. So after my last video on ICS security basics, I got this comment from a subscriber. Let me pull it up here. They said they really appreciated learning about Stuxnet and the Ukraine power grid attack, but wanted to know, what about all the other major incidents? What can we learn from the full history of these attacks? And I thought, you know what? That's precisely the right question. Because there's a whole timeline of attacks that each taught us something critical about protecting our control systems. So today we're going to walk through 25 years of the most significant cyber attacks on industrial control systems. Let's start with some context. Back in 2000, most of our control systems lived in their own little world. We called it an air gap. No internet connection, no corporate network access. If you wanted to mess with a PLC, you had to physically walk up to it with a laptop. But then we got smart, maybe too smart. We wanted remote access, better data analytics, integration with our business systems. So we started connecting everything. Windows-based HMIs, Ethernet everywhere, VPNs for remote troubleshooting. Now, I'm not saying connectivity is bad. It's given us incredible capabilities. But what we didn't fully grasp at the time was that we were creating a highway for trouble to find us. What I'm going to show you today is how attackers evolved right alongside our technology. We'll see insider attacks, nation-state weapons, ransomware chaos, and threats that are active right now. More importantly, we'll talk about what each incident teaches us and how to protect ourselves. Our story starts in Queensland, Australia, in the year 2000. A guy named Vitek Bowden had just been turned down for a job at the local water utility. Now, Bowden wasn't just any guy. He was the contractor who'd helped install their new SCADA system. He knew it inside and out. For 3 months, Bowden sat in his car with a laptop and a radio transmitter, sending commands to 150 sewage pumping stations. The scary part? The system had no idea it wasn't getting legitimate commands. The result? Over 250,000 gallons of raw sewage dumped into parks, rivers, and hotel grounds. Environmental disaster, all from one angry former employee with a laptop. Here's what went wrong. First, their radio communications had zero encryption, zero authentication. Anyone with the right frequency could pretend to be the control center. Second, they had no logging. When something went haywire, they couldn't track what commands were sent or when. Lesson one from Marucci Water. Your biggest threat might already be inside your perimeter. That's why we need strict access control, especially when people leave. Revoke access immediately. And I mean immediately. 8 years later, we had the Turkey pipeline explosion. Initially blamed on hackers, but it turned out to be good old-fashioned physical sabotage by the PKK. But here's the thing. For years, everyone thought it was cyber. That confusion? That's a weapon in itself. Everything changed in 2010 with something called Stuxnet. This wasn't some script kiddie messing around. This was a digital weapon, built by nation-states to physically destroy equipment. Stuxnet broke every rule we thought we knew about security. It jumped air gaps using USB drives. It targeted specific Siemens PLCs controlling uranium centrifuges in Iran. And here's the brilliant, terrifying part. While it was destroying the centrifuges, it was feeding fake data to the operators' screens. The operators thought everything was fine while their equipment was literally tearing itself apart. That's the level of sophistication we were up against. Stuxnet taught us that the air gap is a myth. USB ports, maintenance laptops, vendor access. There are a dozen ways for malware to jump that gap. Now I tell everyone, treat every piece of removable media like it might be infected because it just might be. 2 years later, Shamoon hit Saudi Aramco. This wasn't about destroying physical equipment. It was about data destruction on a massive scale. Over 30,000 computers wiped clean. But here's what's important for us in the control room. Shamoon never made it into the operational network. Why? Network segmentation. That boundary between IT and OT held, and it saved them from a much worse disaster. This is why we preach segmentation like it's gospel, because sometimes it literally saves the day. December 23rd, 2015, Ukraine. Christmas time, and 230,000 people suddenly lost power. Not because of a storm, not because of equipment failure, but because of hackers sitting in Russia. The Russian group called Sandworm spent months preparing. They started with a simple phishing email, moved laterally through the IT network, stole VPN credentials, and finally got into the Scada system. Then, on Christmas Eve Eve, they took control of the operator workstations and started opening breakers. But here's what saved the day, and this is crucial for all of us. The Ukrainian operators were able to restore power in 6 hours by going manual. They sent crews to the substations to physically close the breakers by hand. This is why I always tell people, know your manual procedures, practice them regularly, and keep your field crews trained. When the computers fail, and they might, you need people who can operate the physical process without them. A year later, they came back with something even scarier, crash override. This malware could speak directly to substation equipment using protocols like IEC 6.1.8.5.0 and 104. It didn't need to hijack operator screens, it was having conversations with the equipment itself. The message here is clear. Our protocols aren't secret anymore. Attackers are reverse engineering our industrial communications and building custom tools to speak our language. That's why deep packet inspection and protocol monitoring are becoming essential tools in the OT world. In 2017, we hit a new low that still gives me chills. A group of Russian hackers didn't just go after process control. They went after the safety systems. Safety instrumented systems, SIS, are supposed to be our last line of defense. When everything else fails, the SIS is what stops the explosion, contains the release, saves lives. Well, the Triton malware was specifically designed to attack those systems. They targeted Schneider Electric's Triconex controllers at a petrochemical plant in Saudi Arabia. The attackers reverse engineered the proprietary communication protocol and built malware that could reprogram the safety logic. Think about what they were trying to do. Disable the safety system, then cause an upset in the main process. No automatic shutdown, no relief valves opening, no alarms. The only reason we know about this attack is because the malware had a bug and caused the controllers to fail safe. This changed everything for safety engineers. Your SIS network needs to be treated like Fort Knox. Physical key switches in run mode, strict network segmentation, and monitoring for any unauthorized access attempts. The 2020s brought us new nightmares. First, SolarWinds, a supply chain attack that showed how one compromised vendor could expose thousands of organizations. Russian hackers compromised SolarWinds' software development process and injected malware into routine updates. Thousands of organizations, including utilities, unknowingly installed backdoors into their networks. The scary part for us? Many utilities used SolarWinds' Orion platform to manage both IT and OT networks. One compromised management tool could be a direct path into your control systems. Then came Colonial Pipeline in 2021. Ransomware hit their business network, not their control systems, but they shut down 5,500 miles of pipeline anyway. Why? Because they weren't sure how far the attack had spread. Want to know how it started? One compromised password on an old VPN account. No multi-factor authentication. One password led to the largest fuel disruption in U.S. history. More recently, we've seen hacktivists targeting Israeli-made equipment worldwide. The Cyber Avengers campaign showed that you don't need sophisticated malware when operators leave default passwords on internet-connected PLCs. I can't stress this enough. If you have any device, and I mean any device, connected to the internet with a default password, you're a sitting duck. After 25 years of attacks, the lessons are crystal clear. Defense isn't about one magic bullet, it's about layers. Layer 1, basic hygiene. Change every default password, enable multi-factor authentication everywhere, and patch your systems. I know it sounds boring, but most of these devastating attacks started with basic failures. Layer 2, network segmentation. Your OT network should be protected by more than a prayer and a firewall. Implement a proper DMZ, monitor all traffic between IT and OT, and never, I repeat, never, put PLCs directly on the internet. Layer 3, manual procedures. When Ukraine lost their Scada system, they restored power by hand. Your manual procedures might be the difference between a minor incident and a major disaster. Layer 4, visibility and monitoring. You can't protect what you can't see. Deploy network monitoring that understands industrial protocols. Hunt for threats actively. Don't just wait for alarms. Here's what keeps me up at night right now. There's a Chinese group called Vault Typhoon that's been quietly embedding themselves in our critical infrastructure since 2024. They're not using custom malware that our antivirus might catch. They're using legitimate Windows tools, PowerShell, command prompt utilities, to blend in with normal administrative activity. They're not stealing data or causing immediate disruption. They're positioning themselves for something bigger, pre-positioning access so they can flip a switch when the geopolitical situation changes. This means we can't just install security tools and hope for the best. We need to be actively hunting for threats in our networks, looking for the subtle signs of persistent adversaries. Don't think you have to figure this out alone. The industry has developed some excellent frameworks. ISA IEC 62443 gives you a roadmap for building security into your systems from day one. And MITRE ATT&CK for ICS helps you think like an attacker. It maps out exactly how adversaries move through control systems, so you can build defenses against specific techniques. Use these frameworks. They're built on real-world experience, including every incident I've talked about today. Look, I've been in this business for 35 years. I've seen us go from isolated systems that rarely failed to connected networks under constant attack. But I've also seen how good security practices can stop even nation-state attackers. The threats are real, they're sophisticated, and they're not going away, but we're not helpless. Every attack I've shown you today was preventable with the right combination of technology, procedures, and vigilance. The question is, which side of history do you want to be on? Are you going to be the plant that falls victim to default passwords? Or are you going to be the one that stops the attack because you took security seriously? Now, if you want to take action on what we've covered today, I've got something practical for you. In the description below, there's a link to download my ICS security educational tool. Please note that I constructed this educational discussion tool from these historical events. This resource is not security advice, but for learning and team debates. Use it to teach your team, start conversations, and grasp these topics. But to secure your facilities, you need qualified cybersecurity consultants to examine your surroundings and demands. It doesn't replace cybersecurity, engineering, or expert security evaluations. Also, if you want to access the interactive timeline of events that I showed in this video, I'll link to it below as well. If this deep dive was helpful, hit that thumbs up button and subscribe for more practical control insights. Got questions about securing your specific systems? Drop them in the comments. And remember, security isn't someone else's job. It's all our jobs. Until then, stay secure out there.